Hello, everyone, and welcome to the Community Foundation's Financial Literacy Connect series. My name is Denise Moore. I'm the Director of Education here, and I am excited to talk to y'all about money and, more importantly, about how to save and budget. We here at Community Foundation is focused on helping individuals within the BIPOC community elevate themselves through understanding of skills such as technology, hard skills, resume, but also financials. We want to make sure that you're making those financial choices that is going to be successful for you, not right now only, but also in the future. And so we decided who else better to partner with than Delta Community Credit Union that is out here letting everyone know, hey, this is how you are supposed to handle your finances. And we have Tiana Skipper here. Hello, Tiana. How are you?
Hello, I am good. Hi, everyone.
Please let us know a little bit about yourself as well as the importance of financial literacy.
Of course. Again, thank you all so much for having me. Denise, thank you for extending this invitation, allowing us to be in collaboration with you all to do this series. I'm so glad to be here. As Denise said, my name is Tiana Skipper. Tiana, like the princess, is what I like to say. And I am here from Delta Community Credit Union as one of the community development representatives. It's a lot of community. to tell you just a little bit about the basics of budgeting. I have been with the credit union for almost 5 years now, and I've been in this role for going on 3 years. And I'm so excited to have this opportunity because I'm passionate about sharing the knowledge about financial literacy when it comes to basics of budgeting, understanding credit report. Here at Delta Community, we have an award-winning financial education center that covers it all. So I am just overjoyed at the fact that I'm here with you today because I know when we all hear the word budget, it's kind of like this feeling that comes over us with like a feeling of disbelief, or like a despair, like, oh my God, I don't want a budget. Why do I have to budget? What does that even mean? And so I am ready to get into that with you all and kind of make sure that that feeling is kind of lifted. To make sure, like, now when you hear the word budget, you're like, okay, I can do this. I know how to do this and I know how to do it well. All right. So we can go ahead and get into that right now. To get us started, the first question is, why do we budget? Right? It's the first thing we're thinking about when we're considering, like, hey, I need to make a budget. Why? Why are you considering that? Well, it's multiple reasons, right? Of course, first there's to achieve goals. You want to prevent overspending, right? As she just said, Amazon, Fashion Nova, Shein, all of these brands, Nike, Adidas might send you, oh, we're having a 40% off Memorial Day sale, right? We just went through that, right? And you're like, oh, I need to get this while it's on sale. But budgeting allows us to prevent overspending. And of course, it allows us to pay ourselves first, right? And many of us have heard that term or heard that phrase, I need to pay myself first. But what does it really mean? It means that we're going to decide on a certain percentage or a certain amount that's going to go into our savings automatically from each paycheck. It's taken out of our paycheck. It's going into our savings because we're going to pay ourselves first. That way, we're building our savings and we're being prepared for emergencies, our trips, or whatever it is that we have established in our goals. And of course, it allows us to make informed decisions. Once you look at your money and see where it's going, it allows you to be like, well, maybe I won't go to brunch this weekend, or maybe I won't buy that shirt or those pair of shoes this time, right? I was on the Adidas website. It got me. I wear Adidas all the time. I was on their website this past weekend, Memorial Day, and I saw these pair of shoes. They're like 300. No, they were on sale. I could possibly get them on sale. I think they're $150. I'm like, do I need another pair of tennis shoes right now? So it allows us to make informed decisions and avoid going into too much debt, right? Debt is a scary word, but it's also a word that we shouldn't be afraid of. And so budgeting allows us to really set ourselves in a plan. It clearly shows, how is our money being allocated? And it gives us the freedom to enjoy things based on that financial ability, right? So that way, there's no grief on overspending or getting too far in debt. And we could kind of think of it as like a simple spending plan for our money. And that is why we budget, because it's the foundation for financial stability. That is the biggest component right there. It is the foundation for financial stability. Once you know how you're spending your money, where your money is being allocated to, you have the freedom to kind of do what you want and kind of take your money how you want it to go. So definitely, definitely understand that budgeting, the reasons why we do it, is very important. And our first step is determining our goals, right? And this is pretty simple. I won't take too much time on it, but you have to kind of know where you're going first, right? Like you might say, hey, I want to buy a new house, but how much that house going to cost? Do you have an idea? Do you know when you want to buy it? So making sure that your goals are smart is the best way to kind of determine them. I can give you my personal example. I want to buy my dream car. Well, I should say my dream truck, which is a Ford F-150. I want it all black. I want black rims. I want to be all decked out, right? And I want to buy it next year. So if you know car prices and how they have increased lately, that's going to cost between, if I get it used, maybe between $75,000 to $90,000 for that vehicle. So I got to break that down. Maybe I am saving the amount of money for the down payment, right? And that can possibly only be $10,000 or $5,000, right? Then when do I want to purchase this vehicle? Okay, I now want to walk into the dealership in December of 2025 with my down payment. Okay, now I got the time frame, right? Now I know it's 5,000 or even 10,000. I can break that down to see, well, hey, how much do I need each month and save towards that for that down payment? And is that within my budget? Is it within that time frame? Is that goal achievable, right? And does it align with my values? Yes, because this is my dream car. Is it important to me? It definitely is. So you always want to ensure that your goals are smart and you can track your progress, right? You want to be able to gain control of your finances to achieve these goals. So that is why we say, hey, determine your goals first, but also make sure they're not general, they're not vague, okay? You know, you can say you want to go to Aruba. Okay, well, when do you want to go? How much is it going to cost you? Do you know where you want to stay at? How much is that hotel or that resort? How much is the flight? And you have to add all of those things in when you're considering about, you know, things that you want to accomplish in life, whether it be buying a new house, taking a trip to Aruba or Dubai, you know, buying a new car. You kind of really have to sit and kind of make sure your goals are smart. I can tell you before I got into this role, I was just saying, I want to buy stuff. Like, I want to take a trip to Europe. I want to do this. But now I'm a little bit more disciplined. So I'm like, okay, I want to take a trip to Europe during this time and for this price. Now, how much do I need to save in order to make sure I can take that trip to Europe and have no worries, right? So when we're thinking about that, it's like, okay, I got my goals. They are established. They're set, right? Good to go. Now let's go into the steps to create that spending plan, right? And it's pretty simple. You think of it like, hey, I'm considering, I feel like it's a lot when you think about budgeting, but really it is very, very simple. And we're going to go into more details with the following slides. But as you can see, the process is not complicated at all. You're simply just earmarking a predetermined amount of money to your expenses based on your available income. Emphasis on the word available income, right? And you're going to keep track of those expenses while making those adjustments along the way. So, first thing we're going to do, we're going to list all of our income sources. And I mean all of them. And I will get into that in the next slides, but you're going to list all of them. Then you're going to determine where is my money going? What are my expense categories? And one key note here is that your expense categories is not the same as your friends. It's not the same as your mom or your parents. Your expense categories are specific to you. For example, I love getting my nails done. Okay, I am putting that in my budget. My friend, on the other hand, she's like, Tiana, I can buy press-ons. Okay, I don't have to put nails in my budget, right? So these are the things that you consider when you're thinking about expense categories. I tell my homeboys, like, hey, I see you, it's the NBA finals right now, right? Okay, go Dallas. We'll really go Kyrie because he's my favorite player. But hey, are you betting on a parlay? Is that in your budget? Because that's an expense category, right? But you don't think about that. You need to put, and then if you earn money, we're going to talk about how we're going to add that into the budget, right? So your expense category is very simple and very different than mine. I am not betting on the Celtics and the Mavericks because I'm too nervous and I get stressed out. That can be an expense category for me, but it can be one for you, and that's something to consider. Next, we have to balance our income and expenses. All right. Is my income greater than my expenses? Okay. What can I do with the extra money? Are my expenses greater than my income? Where do I need to cut back? How do we manage that cash flow? And then manage your plan. And when you have to make adjustments, make those. Okay. Changes happens, right? Some of us just got our tax refund. That is an income source. We have to add that into our budget for either the month of March or April, right? You might just be like, oh, nah, that's to the side. No, that's income that you need to include in your budget for that month. You got a bonus at work? That's income, okay? So these are things you have to consider. And I definitely wanted to ensure that I tailored this presentation for, being a college student. I was a college student, so I completely understand. So when it comes to those income sources, what are they? Okay, some of us may have a job. I did work study, so I did get a paycheck to help, pay for school. Then you get your refund check. All right. Now that refund check is an income. Although you may receive 5,000 or 3,000 in that one month, in the month of September, okay, you might need to break that down for like, okay, if this is going to go towards rent, then that's income for your refund check for September, 1,500. 1,500 for October, 1,500 for November, right? Add that into your budget. And I'm telling you, I definitely know it's not going to be easy the first go around, but you definitely have to just kind of take the time and get used to it, right? I have a meeting with my homegirl this afternoon and we're going over her budget, right? So definitely it's not like, oh, I got it immediately. I am still working on my budget. I make changes all the time. I have a spreadsheet now, and you'll be able to see that as well. But you really have to ensure like you're listing all of your income sources. Don't forget to include everything. Everything is included. Your side hustle. If you're going to pick up a second job, that income needs to go into your budget. If your parents give you money, my mama randomly sent me $100 the other day. I'm like, oh man, I have to put that in the budget. Okay. Because that is some income that I was not expecting to receive, but I did. So I need to see where that money went, right? And there's interest. If you have a high yielding savings accounts, is that going to be interest that you're actually using? Is that going to be considered part of your income? Gifts, when it's your birthday, that gift cards, cash that you receive, that's income source, right? So you have to include that in your budget during those times, right? And then for those of us who have a variable income, right? We do freelance work or a job that either pays commission or cash and it fluctuates, what you can do is start with your lowest monthly estimate. And then you budget for the smallest amount because it's easier to go up from there, right? So, hey, like if you're a server, a lot of us do serving and bartending jobs, all right? What is the lowest amount you may receive in for a month, for a week or a month, right? What are the slow months, right? Maybe December, January, February, they're typically pretty slow during that cold and winter season. Okay. How much did you earn last January? Kind of see where you were based at, all right? Kind of estimate. And then what you want to do from there is use that amount to kind of determine your budget. And what you can do is kind of define your essential monthly expenses first, because you do have that variable income. You may be very low in January, February, March, but as soon as the sun comes out, starting March and April, then your income may double, right? So you have to define what your essential monthly expenses are first, and then you have to track your spending meticulously. You got to make sure you know exactly where your money is going when you're a server or a bartender or a bottle girl, wherever, you want to make sure you're tracking your spending because it's a lot of cash, a lot of fast money, right? So you really have to ensure you know where that money is going. Next, estimate that lowest monthly income and then identifying those non-essential expenses when you're looking at your budget. Okay. So you know, like, hey, this is my essential. I'm going to track my spending. Here's what I estimate will be my lowest monthly income. I'm going to establish my budget off of that. I'm going to identify those other expenses that I have that are non-essential. And then I'm going to keep my budget accessible. I'm going to keep it nearby because you're going to always have to come to it when you have that variable income because of the changes. Whether you be like, oh, out of nowhere, you just had a good day during the slow month and you earned an extra $500. So you want to make sure your budget is accessible so that way you can account for any changes that happen. Next is the fun part, right? Determining those monthly expenses. What do we have? Okay. We have rent. For those of us who have a car, we have gas, car insurance. If you have a car note, like you have to determine your monthly expenses. You got your fixed ones, which is typically like your rent and any utility that doesn't change, like your phone bill is typically the same, right? Or your car insurance is typically the same for a year. Those are your fixed expenses. So you want to get all of those down. Then you want to get all of your variable expenses down. What does that look like? Is it the gym? You got a gym membership, personal care, right? All of those need to be put into that expense category. And then you have periodic expenses. Like I am a homeowner, I have to pay property taxes. So during the month that I pay property taxes, I put that expense in that month. So that way I'm prepared for it, right? I know that property taxes are typically paid in October. Okay, cool. That's a periodic expense I have to account for. And of course, a lot of times people make a mistake and they don't have savings as an expense category, but it is because that money is being deducted out of your income, right? You're automatically taking that money over there, right? So when you're writing the budget, savings is in there. You want to ensure that your savings is a part of your budget. That is an expense category. It goes under expenses and, a deduction, right? And then, of course, debt, credit cards, you want to put that into your budget. That's a part of your monthly expenses. And I'm actually going to show you all a template real quickly of a budget that you can kind of look at and kind of see, right? And then, of course, you got utilities, right? We got electricity. It's hot outside right now. If your AC is blasting all day, I wish you the best of luck because that bill is going to definitely increase. Some of us have electricity and gas. That's what we have to account for. You have your water bill, all right? Some of us have a trash bill. You got Wi-Fi. It's like, when does the list stop? Okay. But hey, you are an adult now. You're in college. You're paying for these things. You have to budget for it, okay? So as you can see, you can kind of play with how you want to label your expenses. It can be necessary. You can put discretionary. One size does not fit all. So like I said, you create categories that make sense to you, okay? But let's take a look at an example of a budget real quick. All right. So here is a household budget that I kind of created for you all to make sure that, hey, you're able to kind of see, what a budget on a spreadsheet may look like, right? So let's say we got our paycheck here. I am working on campus. I just use my personal example. I used to work at our employee fitness gym here at Kennesaw State University. And so I got a paycheck. I'm trying to account for inflation with things that right now. So let's say I was making about $1,000 a month. Okay, cool. And that's my take-home pay. That's after taxes. I had about $1,000 a month, right? And then, of course, I had a side hustle. I was serving at this restaurant called On the Border. It's like a Mexican restaurant, if you haven't heard of it. So I was working there, and there I would bring home probably an additional $1,500 a month. Okay, cool. Right? So first thing first, I list all of my income sources. And that's all I may have right now is just my paycheck and my side hustle. And then of course, you can change it. You can put serving job or whatever you want to label it as, you're able to do so. Then next, you go down to your savings. Remember, we pay ourselves first. So that's why savings is that next category. That's why it's an expense, all right? You may have an emergency savings, right? Let's say I want $50 or $100 to go there each month, okay? Next, I know I have a trip coming up. I'm supposed to go to Houston. So you're going to Houston, that's a simple city, with some friends, you know, that's some expenses you have to account for. You know, you're going there in about 3 months, so you're putting a little bit of extra money to the side. So let's say I have $150 going into my travel savings, right? All right. Now let's get into those daily expenses. All right. There's groceries, right? How much is groceries costing about a month? Are you at home just eating ramen noodles? I know when I was in college, I could not eat ramen noodles. I had like a bad, traumatizing experience in high school where there was like noodles all over my kitchen. So I just got traumatized. And so I could not eat ramen noodles in college. So, you know, my grocery bill was maybe a little bit higher. And, you know, you may have a elevated palate, so you might be a little bit higher as well. So let's say our groceries is about $125 a month. Because, you know, inflation got groceries high. So for a single person, that's, you know, pretty good, right? Then you have gas, okay? Gas, maybe you're not going that many places. You're able to walk. You stay on campus, so you're walking, so you don't spend that much on gas. But let's leave that maybe at $75 a month. All right? And you have a small car. You got a Toyota Corolla, okay? So you're good. It's $75 a month. Don't take you that much to fill up, okay? Then there's dining out. You want to hang out with friends, go out to a cafe where you're not using your meal plan and you're going to a restaurant or a K-pot barbecue spot, you know, you want to try those places. But so you have to add that into your budget. So let's say we're going to do about $100. Then there's clothes. Now, clothing is necessary. So this expense category can get a little shaky because if you're buying just all the expensive items, then there's something we need to discuss. But if you're buying like your basic needs and you're shopping on some of your favorite places, you know, we don't want you to sacrifice what you want, but you know, you just want you to be mindful and definitely be feasible in regards to clothing. So right now, my clothing budget, and I don't even shop that much for clothes, but right now my clothing budget is about $200 a month. Okay. I'm not going to talk about what happened in April. That was my birthday month, and things went a little haywire. Okay. But right now, starting in June, because I'm back to being very strict on my budget, you know, my clothing is $200 a month. And then you have personal care. And that can be hygiene products. Say you get facials, say you get your lashes done, you get your brows done. If you're a female, fellas, you know, sometimes y'all like to get pedicures and stuff too. Personal care, just taking care of yourself, whether it be going to yoga class. What does that look like? How much is that costing you a month, right? We're gonna put that in there. I said that clothing twice. I'm gonna move that. Next, we have school supplies. That's something we may have to come out of pocket for. So let's just say that's about $30. Then you may have a pet. Right now, we don't have a pet, so we can save a little money there. All right. Entertainment is just hanging out. Okay. That doesn't mean you're going to a restaurant that time because dining out can also be just fast food. Entertainment is like going to a restaurant with your friends. That's definitely can be a very expensive category, whether it be movies, concerts, shows, festivals. It's summertime. There's all these events. Literally, I feel like there's a festival every weekend. You know, that is going into that category, right? So, you know, I'm gonna say that you all like to kind of hang out just a little bit. So I'm gonna put you at $150. And then gifts, that's for if anybody has a birthday, you always have a friend with a birthday. It's always somebody's birthday. But they know we in college, right? So hopefully they'd be okay with $25, $10, whatever we got that month, okay? All right. So let's go ahead and take a look, all right? We also have down here, I'm gonna highlight that real quick, miscellaneous expenses. And those are expenses that you kind of didn't expect, but they just come out of nowhere. Sometimes that might be some things you bought from the dollar store, decor. Let's say you wanted to dress up your dorm or your room or your apartment for the holiday. That can kind of go into miscellaneous. Just different type of things that are kind of random goes into that category. So I always put that at $100 a month. All right. Now, really, I did y'all a favor and to not scare you all because I didn't go directly into our big expenses. I went to the small ones just to kind of get like a taste of where we are. But if we go into our big expenses, let's go with the major room. Let's go to rent. And right now, rent is very, very expensive. Okay. I don't even want to think about it, but we are today. But luckily, we are in an apartment. We have two roommates. So that's good for us, which still is about maybe $2,100 a month right now in Atlanta, if you can find one, because that's typically the price for a one bedroom. But we're just gonna say we found a very good deal. They were still doing construction, so they gave us a three bedroom. I'm gonna just say it has one and a half bath to account for it, and that our rent is now $700 a month. Okay. Luckily, we don't have a car loan. Our parents gave us a car. They handed it down to us, so we don't have no payment there. But we do have a credit card, and right now we do have a balance, and we have to pay that each month. So we're gonna put $50 right there. All right. Cool. As you can see here, I'm already at $645 left for the month, and I haven't even gotten into my utilities. All right, so let's get into those. Okay, car insurance. Right now, car insurance has definitely increased over the past year or so. And so, right now, I would say car insurance can be from 150 on average to 200, especially if you have anything on your car record. So, let's go with 175. We'll go in the middle. Then you got your electricity bill. Like I said, it's hot outside right now, and you just keep leaving that AC on. So they're like, okay, $125. All right. But your apartment is all electric, so you don't have gas. So don't have to worry about that category. But you do have a water bill. All right. We'll put that at $65 a month. Then you got your cell phone bill. And y'all know y'all like to have the iPhone 15, iPhone 14 Pro Max. So you got that little device payment on your bill, along with the gigabytes, along with the data. So that's already about, but you got a little auto pay discount and you got the student discount. All right, we'll put you at $85 a month, right? Then there's Wi-Fi. Okay, you know we need the internet, gotta pay for that. Let's put that on average at $55. All right. Some of us may have a Ring camera. If you have a Ring camera and you want to go back and see, because y'all like to post that on TikTok and do all of those little funny videos, you got to pay for that monthly subscription of that Ring camera. Okay. So you may get the camera for free, but you have to pay for the subscription. That's about $5 a month. Okay. So we're going to add that in there. And then any streaming services, Netflix, Hulu, HBO Max, Starz, Showtime, Disney Plus, even with the bundles, they're costing about the same price as cable. So we're gonna go ahead and put that at about $65 a month. And then we go to the gym. Let's not forget the gym. All right. Okay, we go to Planet Fitness. All right, we can do like $10. We can go do the $10 a month plan. But look at those expenses. And that is definitely just a little bit. And we only have $60 left for the month. But there's a thing called zero-based budgeting to where you got to account for where that $60 is going. So you want to know everything. Let's say you want to have some cash on hand. We're going to call that petty cash. And you like to have at least $40. All right, now we're down to $20 a month. Okay. Jesus Christ. What happened? Let's say we accidentally left the water bill on. We left for vacation and we left the AC on. I'm sorry. And now that bill is 175. Now I'm in the red, right? So these are things you have to account for when you're going and looking and thinking about your budget. And I'll be able to share this template with you all if anyone wants to use the spreadsheet to start their budgeting method. You'll be able to have this because, as you can see, you have the budget as the first tab, and then you go into each month, right? And it'll even carry over if you have a plus or minus from the previous month, it will carry that over. So that way it can go into each month. All right. So I'll make sure I share this template with you. But that is just a quick example of what budgeting looks like on a day-to-day. When you have to just kind of sit down and actually set it and determine all of your monthly expenses, you start thinking about things you want to cut out, especially when you're looking at ways to discover your spending leaks. Where are some things that are little or even big that add up over time? And you're like, oh my goodness, where does this even come from? It could be Starbucks. It could be Target. Target gets everyone. Between Target and Starbucks, I feel like those are some of the biggest spending leaks for people because you kind of forget and you just go in there and you're looking to buy one thing and here you are buying multiple things. Okay. So that may be a spending leak. My spending leak was food. I am a foodie. I'm going to eat food all the time. I want to try something new. Okay. I want to try this new restaurant. Right. But that's a spending leak. Okay. Even with coupons or whatever I may use, that adds up over time. So this is where you do it. This is where you really do look at your bank statements and your online statements, like, where is my money going? Okay. And how do I spend money now? Where are these spending leaks at? Where are some things I'm not aware of that's actually draining my budget? Okay. So that is the time to kind of look at those things because you'll see how they add up over time. I remember when I first looked at how much I was spending on food, I think last year, and it was like $500 a month. And I said, oh my goodness, I gotta relax. That is way too much. That is way too much. So I definitely worked on cutting that down, but you definitely need to identify your spending leaks and figure out how you can make changes to those. Next. As we mentioned earlier, is that hey, now that you decided to really take, a serious look at your budget and you decided what your expenses are, now it's time to really assign that predetermined amount to each category. And this is where you're going to make some changes into your some habits that you have because you want to set your proposed spending. And you want the goal is to match the income with the expenses. You got to definitely know, like, hey, this is my paycheck. This is how much I'm going to have at the end of each month after taxes. Here are my expense categories. And like I said earlier, if the income is greater than the expense, then you might want to save more or you can pay off debt, right? But if the expenses are greater than the income, we need to consider where those changes can be made, right? So that's definitely something you want to take a look at when it comes time to balance your income and your expenses and really manage your cash flow. All right. So next we have just a suggested budget guidelines. There's so many different budgeting guidelines that you can use. Some people do 50, 30, 20, where 50% goes to essentials, 30% goes to wants, and 20% goes to savings. Or there's an option where only 10% goes to savings. 15% goes to transportation, but that percentage comes off that monthly income amount, right? So once you list your income sources, you know how much money after taxes, just as a reminder, you take a percentage of what's going to my housing and my essential needs, what's going to other, which is like wants and things like that. So this is just two budgeting guidelines that you can use. There's definitely a lot more out there, but always kind of figure out which one is best for you and see how you want to equip that in into your life. Now that we have our plan, we have set our plan, we are going to manage our plan, okay? We're going to track these expenses regularly. And there are definitely different ways to track expenses. Some people do the receipt method. Some people go back and look at all of their banking statements and online statements. And I have a slide right after this about how you can track your spending. Then you want to continue to manage those spending leaves that we discussed. Once you identify them, manage them. You want to pay your bills regularly. And then, of course, analyze and revise your plan. Because does it still fit with your goals? Things change. Life be life, and right? So things change over time. So always analyze and revise your plan and ensure that it still is aligned with your goals. Next, you always want to review your goals, especially annually and after any major life changes, right? If anything major happens, say your car broke down, let's review our budget, okay? Maybe I can't save as much as I want to because now I had to purchase a new vehicle and I got to recoup that. So always take the time to manage your plan. I think that's where the hard work comes in at. A lot of times we can go and write the budget down, but once we start actively using our budget, managing the plan can be difficult, but that is what keeps us on the right track. Okay. And we're going to talk about this next time. How has budgeting been for you? Have you been able to manage your plan, right? Like I said, each year during my birthday month, my plan goes out the window and I have to come back again, right? To remanage it. Right. I'm looking at the next half of the year and I'm ready to manage my plan. Okay. So different methods to track spending. At Delta Community Credit Union, in our app, we have a money management tool. And a lot of credit unions and banks have this app or this tool where you can kind of see the categories based off the transactions that they see of where your money is going. And they're kind of like, oh, this is clothing, this is food, this is gas. That is kind of what that is. So if your credit union or bank has that resource for you, definitely make sure you're using it. Like I said, at Delta Community Credit Union, we have it. It's known as our money management tool. And that's sometimes when some of those apps, especially budgeting apps, want to link to your bank account, it's so that they can basically track your spending in this way. Of course, like I said, you can use a spreadsheet, there's computer programs, apps, whatever your bank has. If you're very, very old school, you can use a checkbook ledger and write everything down. I'm a little bit old school. I definitely do write everything down, and I definitely made sure I brought this with me because I have my little budget book here. I'm a receipt method person, but that's also because I have the Fetch app. So that way I scan all of my receipts to get those like reward points. See, there's a little incentive to everything, right? So I scan that receipt to get those reward points that will ultimately I can cash for like gift cards to restaurants, gas, clothing stores, things like that. But I use the receipt method. So here is my little budgeting book that you can see here, where I kind of go through and I write all of my expenses down. I go there, just all of them just written down there. And then right now you can see some stuff on the way. But this is like a paper clip of all my receipts for the month of May. Right. So I'm a receipt method type of person. But there's also the envelope method. Now, the envelope method you may have heard of, that's where you kind of take the actual cash, but many of us don't like to have cash on us anymore. But you have the cash, you have it in the envelope, you write entertainment, eating out, gas, whatever it is, and you spend whatever you put in that envelope. And once that envelope is empty, that's it. So to show y'all how, to share my own personal experience, I am very serious about my budget going into the latter half of the year. I have another book right here. And this is going to actually be my envelope method, right? Somebody actually gifted this to me, so thank you to them. But it has all of the envelopes, and you can put, the categories on each one. Now, what I may do is I may do cash for some of them. But like I said, I like to use like my American Express credit card when I'm at a restaurant and things like that. So that way I can earn Sky Miles and earn points. So if you're like that, you want to make sure you're still using getting those points. You can put your receipts in here. So I'm doing a combination. So it's either going to be cash or the receipts. So that way my receipts are not everywhere in this book, but they'll be nicely labeled in my envelope method here. And you can find these little books on TikTok shop from what I heard. Instagram shop, they're everywhere. Very, very cheap that you can use, or you can create your own. Okay, you can go ask one of your instructors or go to the front office and see if they got some envelopes and say, hey, can I borrow a few? Right? So those are definitely things you can do to kind of track your spending and just take a look at everything and make sure that, hey, I know exactly where my money is going. Because you want to avoid these drains on your budget. Lack of savings for when an emergency happens. I was driving down 75 and I felt like my tire was making like a weird sound. So I got to take it to the mechanic. And he's like, oh, it's not your brakes. It's not your tire. It's your wheel bearing. I have no clue what that is. But it's going to cost you 400 and something dollars, right? That can be a major pitfall. If you don't have that savings account, if you're not paying yourself first, where are you going to get that money from when that happens, right? That is why you want to ensure you have that savings account to avoid those pitfalls, whether it be medical emergencies, repair bills, vacations where you spend a little bit too much money, especially during the holiday season where you want to get everybody a gift. And then next thing you know, it's January 3rd and you're like, oh my God, I shouldn't have bought everybody a gift. Yeah, you want to make sure you avoid those major pitfalls because they're really just a lack of planning. You got to plan for those things. You got to plan for that holiday spending, plan for the vacation, and having that emergency savings account is planning for emergencies, repair bills, and things like that. I actually have two savings accounts. Well, three. I have my emergency savings account, which is for big emergencies, big things that happen. And then I have a rainy day fund. And that's for little small things. Say I need a new tire. Say I need some new windshield wipers. Or I went to the doctor. I got to pay a copay of $150. That's kind of like a rainy day for me. Like, you know what that means. So you can have a rainy day fund, a rainy day savings account. You don't have to have just one savings account. Be aware of that, okay? You can definitely have multiple. And you can, disperse your money out however you need to, right? And then, of course, those spending leaks with those impulse decisions when you're impulse shopping or eating out frequently or not, watching, what's in your account. So you're constantly having to pay either overdraft fees and things like insufficient fund fees. That's a spending leak on your budget. Even interest charges, when you have that credit card, when you're paying that extra money in interest, you're paying extra money. Right. So that's a spending leak, right? Unused subscriptions. Go and look at all the subscriptions you are paying for and make sure that you're using all of them. Okay. Let's definitely consider that because that's, again, a spending leak. So you want to kind of take the time and really review where your money is going so just to avoid having any drains on your budget. After that, we always want to look for ways to save money, right? We have to. We want to make sure we're paying, having money to the side for the fun things as well as things that may occur. So pay down debt. Try to see if you can get a lower rate, interest rate if possible. I always ask or if there's a promo going on. I think American Express sent me like a current promo that they're doing for like 3 months. Like, oh, it's 0% APR for any purchases during this time. Okay, I will accept that, right? Lower interest rates, so I don't have to pay interest on any purchases that I made during this time period. And I'm making sure I'm paying my balance off each month so that way that balance doesn't carry over. So when that promo ends, I'm not paying interest on that remaining balance. Of course, you want to use your credit cards wisely, pay those balances in full, shop around for insurance, especially car insurance. I literally had to tell my little sister this. She had Progressive and her insurance went from 230 to 400. And I said, well, you need to shop around for insurance always. When it comes that time for that automatic renewal, like you can tell them to take a pause, hold on, or make sure, like, hey, let me see if there's a better quote I can get somewhere else. I definitely shop around for insurance if I'm looking to save money as well. Make saving an automatic habit. Have those funds go directly into your savings accounts. But once you see your paycheck, you think it's just 1700 when really it was 1800 because $100 already went to your savings account. So that makes you not even miss that money, okay? Because that saving is an automatic habit. Take advantage of employer matches. If you already are in an entry-level job and they have matches for your 401k, take advantage of those. And then, of course, save your bonuses and tax refunds. You don't always have to spend them to go on vacation or buy a new TV. You can go ahead and put them to the side, for a rainy day or for an emergency. Okay, you don't always have to go on that spring break trip with your friends when you get that tax refund back or that refund check. Okay, so these are ways that you can definitely save money, and you want to look for those when you're budgeting, you're trying to establish, and you want to spend money without any worry. This is how you do so. All right. So, in closing, when developing your personal action plan, developing your spending plan, you're going to set those financial goals, and they are going to be smart, specific, measurable, achievable, relevant, time oriented. Those goals are going to be smart, right? Then you're going to create that spending plan. You're going to create your budget, okay? Listing all of your income sources, identifying your expense categories, right? Then you set those spending limits, all right? I took my eating out budget, I took it all the way down to 150, okay? After that 150 is gone, that's it. That's my spending limit. I've been grocery shopping like crazy. I don't meal plan. I just go cook. Okay. At the end of the day, after the gym, I'm like, let me just make a salad, a chicken Caesar wrap or something really quick, Even quick meals that helps you save money, right? Then track your spending. Do whatever method works for you. The receipt method, the envelope method, whatever method works for you, that is what you want to do. And then last but not least, review your spending plan annually. As you can see, I'm preparing for the second half of the year, so I do it twice a year, kind of take a look at where I'm at, and I audit my progress and adjust goals. Honestly, I was hoping to buy my dream truck the end of this year, but I had to adjust, okay? I had to make some changes, right? And so I'm going to buy it the end of next year. So you always audit your progress and adjust your goals. So you make sure you identify your spending leaks as we discussed, and really take a look at these things that are really impacting your budget and disrupting your cash flow and how you manage your cash flow. Okay. Just don't forget to give yourself grace. You will not get it the first go round or the second go round. Take your time, get into the habit, and you will be okay overall. All right. And just so you know, here at Delta Community Credit Union, for our members, we have a third-party partner known as Balance that provides free financial counseling and additional resources. And even though you may not be a member just yet, or if you're still interested in finding out about more financial resources and tools, you can use Balance just by listening to this workshop and attending today. Just let them know if you give them a call that you attended one of Delta Community's financial literacy workshops, and they'll still be able to have a free consultation with you. But Balance definitely gives you all kind of calculators, articles, and toolkits that you can use as for free, as a free resource. Just by attending or listening to this workshop, it goes over student loans, home buying, budgeting, money management. I used it from when I purchased my house just to understand the terminology and how much money I may need for a down payment. So definitely, definitely use this as a resource as it is free to you. And again, I just want to say thank you for just taking the time and joining this workshop today. I definitely hope you learned something. Or something you want to start practicing, okay? As you can see, I have my two books here. When you see me next time, you're going to hear about the changes I've made in preparation for the second half of the year. I told my friends I am inside, I'm not outside. Don't look for me if it's not free, I'm not coming, okay? But thank you again for joining me today. If you have any questions, feel free to contact us or visit one of our local branches, and you can always find more of these financial literacy workshops at deltacommunitycu.com/events, where we have a whole list of financial webinars that we host throughout the year. All right. And that's all, everyone. Thank you so much.
Thank you so much, Tiana. I really have enjoyed this first series. And for everyone to know, we have two more after this. So do not worry, you have not missed out. Please definitely take this information, take these resources. Thank y'all so much, and y'all have a great day.